Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 1st of May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion is available in the description section below. Also, for the benefit of smartphone users, the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion is available in the comment section. Let us now move on to the discussion of our news articles. The first topic of the day is the editorial titled An Employment-Oriented Economic Policy. This editorial discusses in brief about the reason for the contracted demand in Indian economy, which has led to loss of the jobs, and some of the author's suggestions to improve the existing situation. This editorial appears in page 10 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and in page 8 of Delhi edition. The analysis of this editorial will be relevant in your mains preparation in General Studies paper 2 under Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising Out of Their Design and Implementation. And next, in your General Studies paper 3 under Indian Economy and Issues Related to Employment. And next, under Inclusive Growth and Issues Arising from It. Let us move on to the analysis of the editorial. In the first part of the editorial, the author has discussed about the reasons that has led to unemployment in India and calls for a review of RBI's role. The author then gives some suggestions to improve RBI's role in the second part of the editorial. And finally, if you see in the final part, the author shares his ideas about some ways of job creation. Now, let us see the first part. The author raises the concern that the crucial link between the macroeconomic policies of the government and the present state of unemployment has not been focused in any of the heated debates on jobs. The author stresses the fact that the two immediate tasks of the new government should be to focus on an employment-based macroeconomic policy. To validate the de-link phenomenon between the macroeconomic policy and employment generation, the author has discussed the state of Indian economy of the present government and also the previous government. Fiscal consolidation measures and inflation targeting of the present government are something that has been inherited from the previous government, says the author. Here, he also notes that the high levels of inflation that prevailed around 2012-13 would have partly been due to the abnormal hikes in the procurement price. This made the then government to target on inflation, says the author. But too much of inflation targeting has led to the hike in the interest rates by RBI. If you see here, the hike in the interest rates has triggered instability in two ways. The first impact of hiking the interest rates is on the cost of financing in a floating interest rate regime. Now we need to know what is meant by floating interest rate regime. It means the periodic changes made in the interest rates by the central banks of nations on assessing the market situations. Here in India, the central bank is the RBI. The cost of financing of any projects is now higher with the higher interest rates, if you see. This would lead to higher borrowing rates, triggering a financial instability. Secondly, higher interest rates would also lower the growth of the economy in general. It means that the company's growth in the economy would also be slow. This condition would slowly trigger financial instability. Financial instability leads to higher stress in the banking sector, where the non-performing assets will be on the continuous rise. We have seen a huge percentage of NPAs, especially after the change in the method of how NPAs are now being classified since 2015. The present trending scenario is the spectacular collapse of the financial giant ILFS. ILFS is nothing but infrastructure leasing and financial services. The rising debts of ILFS has led to its financial crunch, and this has undermined the confidence in the financial sector of India in general. Hence, the author calls a review of RBI's role in Indian economy. So, the key takeaway from this first part of the editorial is that number one, policy holds back investment, and number two, the contractionary monetary policy has adversely impacted the employment opportunities in India. Now let us move to the second part. In the second part of the editorial, the author has given some suggestions on reviewing the RBI's role. Here, the author has stressed on granting wider powers to RBI to carry out its policies without any government intervention. At present, Here one can see the interventions of the government in the form of finance ministry and also its nominees on the RBI board who are trying to have an influence on RBI's decisions. Thus, here the author stresses on limited or reduced government intervention in RBI's policy matters. The author has also voiced his opinion that RBI should publicly voice against the government on financial matters. Next, the economic policies should be designed based on the movements in the financial markets. This would make the policy decisions relevant, he tells. Also, the government should focus on the link between the macroeconomic policy and employment, such that the policies should generate employment instead of cutting the employment opportunities. Now, coming to the final part of the editorial, in this part, the author suggests that the employment opportunities can be given by tapping the MNREGA scheme properly. This can be done by increasing the budgetary support for MNREGA scheme and ensuring timely payments in digital mode to the beneficiaries. Also, the author suggests to extend this MNREGA scheme to the urban areas. If you see MNREGA scheme, it is a rural employment guarantee scheme, but the author wants to extend the scheme to the urban areas so that it would generate employment in the urban areas. The author insists that the government needs to review the functioning of the MNREGA scheme at the ground level as well, which is the third point. He has quoted the example of the state of Kerala, where the MNREGA workers have removed only the shrub growth, but the garbage beneath the shrub growth was hidden and they did not remove that particular shrub growth. The author tells that such kind of acts lead to unaccountability in the MNREGA system. The author insists on MNREGA because there are two benefits that are present in this particular scheme. First, it provides a massive employment generation throughout India. Second, it leads to asset creation like renewed water sources, primary infrastructure like roads, etc. Thus, there is a meaningful expenditure of public money under this MNREGA scheme. Finally, the author stresses the need to utilize MNREGA for proper waste management in both rural and urban areas, such that it would lead to a cleaner environment and also create jobs at the same time. Accountability can also be reflected when the objectives of the MNREGA program are met. The author finally concludes that this would also lead to realize Mahatma Gandhi's vision of clean India. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Have a look at the practice mains question. We shall discuss at the end of the session. Moving on to the next news article. The second news article of the day is, Phoni is India's strongest April cyclone in 43 years, says meteorologists. This news article appears on page number 9 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and on page 7 of Delhi edition. The discussion under this article is relevant in your prelims examination, in current events of national importance and in physical geography. And in the main syllabus, it is relevant in General Studies Paper 1 under important geophysical phenomena such as cyclone. This news article talks about the cyclone system Phoni, which is lying about 600 km east of Visakhapatnam and 800 km south of Puri. And according to records from the Indian Meteorological Department, it is the first severe cyclonic storm to have formed in the month of April in India's oceanic neighborhood since the year 1976. The experts also say that it is a consequence of global warming, as this is a cyclone that's forming due to the warming of the Bay of Bengal basin. According to the data from the IMD's Cyclone Statistics Unit, from the year 1965 to the year 2017, the Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea have collectively registered 46 severe cyclonic storms. Out of this, 28 of them happened in the months of October-December, while 7 of them have been in the May month, and only 2 were recorded in April month, that is 1966 and in 1976. IMD's forecast also says that Cyclone Phoni is expected to intensify to an extremely severe cyclonic storm by Wednesday, and by May 4, it will make landfall in Odisha as a very severe cyclonic storm. Meteorologists also point to Phoni's extended gestation, as the storm had been building up since April 25. And it is expected to make landfall only after 3rd of May, which is almost 10 days. But on an average, tropical cyclones form and make landfall in less than a week. Phoni's slow progress is also a matter of worry, as the longer the cyclone hovers in the ocean, the more moisture and energy it gains from the ocean, and stronger is its impact along the coast. In this news article, we have seen so many technical terms like tropical cyclone, landfall, etc. Now let us understand these terms to have a comprehensive idea about the cyclonic storm Phoni. A tropical cyclone is a rotational low pressure system in tropics. The tropics extends from the Tropic of Cancer at 23.5 degree north latitude to the Tropic of Capricorn at 23.5 degree south latitude. A tropical cyclone forms when the central pressure falls by 5 to 6 hectopascal or HPA from the surrounding and the maximum sustained wind speed reaches 34 knots, that is about 62 km per hour. It is a vast violent whirl of 150 to 800 km spiraling around a center and progressing along the surface of the sea at a rate of 300 to 500 km a day. The word cyclone is derived from Greek word cyclos. It means coiling of a snake. The terms hurricane and typhoon are region specific names for a strong tropical cyclone. Tropical cyclones are called hurricanes over the Atlantic Ocean, and if you see, typhoons are called over the Pacific Ocean. Tropical cyclone's winds rotate counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere and it rotates clockwise in the southern hemisphere. This is because the Earth's rotation sets up an apparent force which is called the Coriolis force that pulls the winds to the right in the northern hemisphere and to the left in the southern hemisphere. So, when a low pressure starts to form over north of the equator, the surface winds will flow inward, trying to fill in the low and will be deflected to the right and a counterclockwise rotation will be initiated. The opposite, that is a deflection to the left and a clockwise rotation, will occur south of the equator in the southern hemisphere in the same manner. Tropical cyclones are like giant engines that use warm or moist air as fuel. That is why they form only over warm ocean waters near the equator. The warm moist air over the ocean rises upward from near the surface. Because this air moves up and away from the surface, there is less air left near the surface. Another way to say the same thing is that the warm air rises, causing an area of lower air pressure below. Air from the surrounding areas with higher air pressure pushes into the low pressure area. Then that new air becomes warm and moist and rises too. As the warm air continues to rise, the surrounding air swirls in to take its place. As the warmed moist air rises and cools off, the water in the air form clouds. The whole system of clouds and wind will start spinning and growing, fed by the ocean's heat and water evaporating from the surface. Storms that form north of the equator spin counterclockwise and that form south of the equator spin clockwise as we saw earlier. As the storm system rotates faster and faster, an eye forms in the center. This eye is very calm and clear with very low air pressure. Higher pressure air from the above flows down into the eye. If you see this picture and if you could slice into a tropical cyclone, it would look something like this. The small red arrow shows warm moist air rising from the ocean surface and forming clouds and bands around the eye. The blue arrows show how cool dry air sinks in the eye and between the bands of clouds. The large red arrow here shows the rotation of the rising bands of clouds. The low pressure systems over Indian region are classified based on the maximum sustained speed winds associated with the system and the pressure deficit or number of closed isobars associated with the system. The pressure criteria is used when the system is over land and wind criteria is used when the system is over the sea. Now, let us see the term landfall which was mentioned in the article. Landfall is the event of a tropical cyclone coming onto land after being over water. A tropical cyclone is classified as making landfall when the center of the storm moves across the coast, and in tropical strong cyclones, this is when the eye moves over land. This is where most of the damage occurs within a mature tropical cyclone, as most of the damaging aspects of these systems are concentrated near the eye wall. Such effects include the peaking of the storm surge, the core of strong winds coming onshore, and heavy flooding and rains. And these coupled with high waves can cause major beach erosion. Here, storm surge means an abnormal rise of sea level as a cyclone crosses the coast. Sea water inundates the coastal strip, causing loss of life, large-scale destruction to property and crop. Increased salinity in the soil over affected area makes the land unfit for agricultural use for 2 or 3 seasons if you see. And storm surge depends on intensity of the cyclone as maximum winds and lowest pressure are associated with it, and it also depends on coastal bathymetry, that is shallower coastline generates surges of greater heights. The storm surges are by far the greatest killers in a cyclone. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Have a look at the practice prelims question, we shall discuss at the end of the session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The third news article is core sector growth at 5-month high in March. This news article discusses about index of 8 core industries for the month of March. This news article appears in page number 16 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and page number 14 of Delhi edition. Ignore the data statistics given in the news since the values keep changing periodically. All you need to know is about the index of core industries and index of industrial production, which is more important in the preliminary exam under current events of national importance and next under economic development. Moving on to the discussion, the article is about the index of 8 core industries report for the month of March. The report says that the core industries have witnessed the highest growth record of 4.7% compared to the past 5 months. The index report also contains a cumulative growth report of 8 core industries from April 2018 to March 2019, which recorded a growth rate of 4.3% respectively. The index also refers to the recovery of sectors like cement, refinery, steel and coal among the 8 core industries. As told earlier, ignore the statistics. Let us focus on index of 8 core industries report now. The index of 8 core industries report is published every month with base year taken for calculation as 2011-2012. This index is released by the Office of the Economic Advisor. This office comes under the Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade, in short DPIIT, which in turn comes under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. As the name suggests, this index is composed of 8 core industries. These 8 core industries are coal, natural gas, crude oil, refinery products, fertilizer, steel, cement and electricity. Each industry here is assigned a weightage based on the weight of these industries given in the index of industrial production. Of the total weight of index of industrial production, the combined weight of these 8 core industries is 40.27%. Among these 8 core industries, refineries has the maximum weight, which is 28.03%, and fertilizers have the least weight of 2.6% out of the total weightage of 100%. Next, we will see about the index of industrial production. The base year taken for calculation is 2011-12 again. The index is published every month by Central Statistics Office. This office comes under the Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. The index is composed of 3 major industries, namely mining, manufacturing and electricity, with a total number of 407 items. Among this, manufacturing sector has 405 items and mining and electricity has 1 item each. The manufacturing sector has the maximum weightage of 77.6%, mining 14.3% and next electricity has the least weightage of 7.9% for the total weightage of 100%. Next, we will see the importance of both these indices given above. First, these indices act as the lead indicators for the performance of industries and general economic activities that is happening in a particular month. Secondly, these indices also act as a source for policy making. First, for the different ministries of the government, especially the Ministry of Finance, and second, also for certain government agencies like Reserve Bank of India. Both these frame policies based on the performance of these industries. Finally, the indices also act as a source of policy making decisions in private companies, and it is also helpful for the investors and policy analysts to forecast the future economic performance of the country. With this, we come to the end of this news article analysis. Have a look at the practice prelims questions we shall discuss at the end of the session. Let us move on to the next news article. The fourth article of the day is the editorial titled A Washington Pipe Dream, where the author states that the American stance on Iranian oil exports could only cause mayhem in West Asia. This editorial appears in page 10 of Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and in page 8 of Delhi edition. The aspects of this article comes under current events of national and international importance in your prelims preparation and in your mains preparation in General Studies paper 2 under India and its neighborhood relations. Next, under bilateral, regional and global groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, and under effects of policies and politics of developed and developing countries on India's interests. The article appears in the editorial because recently on April 22, the United States has announced that it would not issue any additional significant reduction exceptions to existing importers of Iranian oil who had received such exemptions in November 2018. The day from which the waiver of the significant reductions exceptions will officially come to an end is May 2nd, that is tomorrow. The American demands to Iran, such as cutting oil exports to zero, totally giving up Iran's right to enrich uranium, and closing down all nuclear facilities, even research for peaceful purposes, is called by the author as a fantasy dream or a pipe dream. Pipe dream here refers to unattainable dream. Hence, the article is titled A Washington Pipe Dream. The author provides the possible responses that may be adopted by three countries that are dependent on Iran for their energy, particularly oil. They are India, China, and Turkey. Now, according to the author, China, which is one of the largest importers of oil from Iran, is likely to resist the American demand as it opposes US hegemony and is firmly against unilateral sanctions. Unilateral sanctions means sanctions put by one country on another country or sanctions put by one country on more than one country. Uni means one, so it means one country putting sanctions on one or two or more countries. Coming to Turkey, first let us see things that there are common or overlapping strategic interests. First, with respect to the Kurdish secessionism, Iran and Turkey are on the same page that there shall not be a creation of a separate state for Kurds. The map shown here depicts a claim for reaction of Kurdistan state involving parts of Turkey, Iran, Iraq and Syria. Number two, Turkey and Iran support territorial integrity of Iraq because northern Iraq is under threat from Kurds extremists, meaning northern Iraq is claimed as their own territory by the Kurds. This is opposed by both Iran and Turkey if you see here. Finally, both Turkey and Iran are anti-Saudi Arabia, meaning they have shared interest in matters of Saudi Arabia. The author also talks about Turkey's recent relations with the United States. The Turkey as a nation is angry with the United States as the US has supported the Syrian Kurdish militant group, the YPG. This YPG is having a close relation with the Kurdistan Workers' Party, who in Turkey are claiming a separate state for Kurds. Also, Turkey has decided to buy S-4 missile defense systems from Russia. So because of this, the US is threatening Turkey about sanctions. And this also adds bitterness between Turkey and US. Let us see about Iran now. To the question whether Iran will succumb or yield to the American demand, such as cutting oil exports to zero, totally giving up its right to enrich uranium, closing down all nuclear facilities, even research for peaceful purposes, the author states that Iran, which has not submitted itself for around 40 years till now of unprecedented US sanctions, will now only adopt even more powerful anti-US posture. It plainly implies that Iran will not yield to the United States, and this will prevent or obstruct the US to realize its own strategic objectives in the region of West Asia. Coming to India, according to the author, India is expected to be the weakest responder in comparison with China and Turkey. Keeping in mind the economic relations with United States, note that the USA is India's largest trading partner and a leading source of foreign investment for India. And India needs US to contain China in Indo-Pacific region. US's support is required to gain membership in Nuclear Suppliers Group, if you see, and India cannot afford to mismanage the relations calibrated carefully with US for civil nuclear deals. Keeping all these scenarios in mind, the author says that India is likely to yield to the American sanctions or demands of stopping entire oil imports from Iran after May 2nd, that is tomorrow. Yielding up to the US pressure will cost India heavily, especially with the relations with Iran. Iran is important to India as India is heavily involved in building the Chabahar port in the southern region of Iran. This port is to become a major access route for India to Iran, bypassing Pakistan to Afghanistan and also to Central Asia. So it is bypassing the hostile Pakistani territory. India and Iran has shared interests with respect to opposition to the Pakistan-supported Taliban coming to power in Afghanistan and with also respect to Pakistan as well. Now, you may think why US is not objected to India's investments in Iran's Chabahar port. This is because, as of now, US policy supports Afghan reconstruction and hence it sees India's investments in Chabahar port as a part of its Afghan reconstruction. Therefore, it did not raise any objection at present. Iran has accused Pakistan for sponsoring terrorism in its territory and India has also condemned Pakistan as sponsoring terrorism. The author says India's decision to discontinue oil imports from Iran will create a jam in India-Iran relations and it will be very difficult for India to repair the damage done. Iran may see India as a supporter of USA if India stops importing oil from Iran, and this may cost India very strategically. By strategically, the author here means the strategic location of Chabahar port. If Iran asks India to stop investments in this particular Chabahar port, it will cost India strategically as India will lose the only possibility way to access Central Asia by land that is presently available now. The author has given some implications as a result of this policy of confrontation of United States with Iran. One, it may be welcomed by countries such as Israel and Saudi Arabia, who are US allies. Two, it may lead to another major war in West Asia similar to the Iraq war. Three, Iran is likely to retaliate by withdrawing from the nuclear accord and developing nuclear weapons. What will happen then? Iran developing nuclear weapons will lead US to join with Israel to carry out air and missile strikes on Iran's nuclear facilities. For this, Iran will retaliate by targeting American positions in Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, and some other Gulf countries through proxy warfare or direct warfare. This action-reaction phenomenon will become disastrous for the entirety of West Asia. It could seriously disturb the flow of energy supplies from the Gulf through the narrow Straits of Hormuz. American confrontationist policy towards Iran may be authored by the authors of America's disastrous invasion of Iraq. USA's invasion over Iraq is a reason for the state failure in Iraq after Saddam Hussein, and the interference has also led to the boost of international terrorism such as the Islamic State. Note that these are the tragic consequences of US invasion of Iraq. The author implies any such confrontation policy may lead to history repeating itself. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Have a look at the practice prelims question, which I'll discuss at the end of the analysis session. Now, let us move on to the next news article. The fifth news article of the day is based on multiple articles about the same issue regarding the recent judgment by the Madras High Court on the powers of Lieutenant Governor. The first article titled Madras High Court Curbs Lieutenant Governor's Role in Puducherry appears on page 1 in all the four editions. The second article titled Lieutenant Governor Should Own Moral Responsibility for Stalling Puducherry's Development appears on page number 6 in only in the Chennai edition. The third article titled Article 239A Allows Greater Powers for Puducherry House appears on page number 12 of the Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions and in page 10 of Delhi edition. The information under these articles is relevant in the preliminary syllabus under the areas Current Events of National Importance and next under Indian Polity and Governance, and in the main syllabus in General Studies Paper 2 under the areas Functions and Responsibilities of the Union and the States, next under Issues and Challenges Pertaining to the Federal Structure, Devolution of Powers, next under Separation of Powers Between Various Organs, and next also in the Functioning of the Executive. The Madras High Court had ruled that the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry cannot interfere with the day-to-day administration of the Union Territory when an elected government is in place. The court also said that this constant interference from the Lieutenant Governor would amount to running a parallel government. And further, the court noted that the central government as well as the administrator should be true to the concept of democratic principles. Otherwise, the constitutional scheme of the country of being democratic and republic would be defeated. Here, the administrator mentioned is the Lieutenant Governor because the constitution states that the administrator appointed by the president shall be designated as the Lieutenant Governor. And the court also pointed out that there is a significant difference in the powers conferred on the legislatures of Puducherry and Delhi under Article 239A and under Article 239AA of the Constitution respectively. The Article 239A is pertaining to the Union Territory of Puducherry and Article 239AA is for the National Capital Territory of Delhi. Article 239A states the provision for creating a state legislature or council of ministers or both for the Union Territory of Puducherry. Whereas Article 239AA of the Constitution provides for a detailed provision for the state legislature and the council of ministers for the National Capital Territory of Delhi. This specifically includes no power to make laws under the heads of state lists such as public order, police and land for the National Capital Territory of Delhi. And importantly, when there is a difference of opinion between the state legislature and the Lieutenant Governor, where decision is pending with the President on the matter, the Lieutenant Governor has the power to act based on the urgency of the situation. The court ruled that Article 239AA imposes several restrictions on the legislature of Delhi and no such restrictions had been imposed explicitly in the case of Puducherry under Article 239A. And in case of the Union Territory of Puducherry, these articles symbolizes the supremacy of the legislature over the administrator. It means that the elected government is above the Lieutenant Governor who is the administrator of Puducherry. The judgment said that the government secretaries are bound to take instructions from the ministers and the council of ministers headed by the chief minister. After this judgment, the chief minister of Puducherry V. Narayana Swamy responded that the Lieutenant Governor Kiran Bedi should own moral responsibility for stalling the development and welfare schemes in the Union Territory, which is the second news article. The Lieutenant Governor was also blamed that she had tried to create an impression among the government employees that she was a real administrator. And as a result, the employees were compelled to take orders from her. The judge also disapproved of the alleged practice of government officials being part of social media groups through which the Lieutenant Governor was issuing instructions to them for the redressal of public grievances, and only authorized medium of communication should be used when it comes to issues relating to administration. The judgment was delivered while allowing a petition filed by Congress MLA Mr. K. Lakshmi Narayanan in the year 2017 and quashing two clarifications issued by the Union Home Ministry in the year 2017 with regards to the powers of the Lieutenant Governor. Firstly, the Lieutenant Governor of the Union Territory enjoys more power than a governor of a state and can act without the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. Secondly, the Lieutenant Governor can call for files relating to any case and request the Chief Minister for an update on any doubt or query which may arise. The judge held that these communications had been issued without reference to the constitutional provisions and other laws. Section 44 of the Government of Union Territories Act of 1963 states that there shall be a council of ministers in each Union Territory to aid and advise the administrator who shall act in his or her discretion only in so far as any special responsibilities are concerned. However, since the Act does not specify the special responsibilities in relation to which the Lieutenant Governor could apply his or her discretion, and hence it becomes the obligation of the administrator and the Council of Ministers to avoid issues like these which seem irresolvable and facilitate the smooth functioning of the government in public interest by leaving the political differences apart. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Have a look at the prelims question we shall discuss at the end of the session. Let us move on to the next news article. The sixth and the final news article of the day is about the International Labour Day which is based on the picture that has appeared in the newspaper on page number 3 in your Delhi edition. The information under this discussion is relevant in the preliminary syllabus in the area current events of national and international importance. Today is International Labour Day, also known as International Workers' Day or May Day. One needs to know about the importance of May Day. The day is celebrated to honour the contribution of working men and women globally. Labour Day aims to pay tribute to workers' sacrifices in achieving economic and social rights all over the world. During industrialization, at the beginning of the 19th century, the industrialists used to exploit the labor class and made them work for up to 15 hours a day. The workers rose against this exploitation and demanded paid leaves, proper wages, and breaks for the workforce. Countries including Germany, France, England, and US saw demand for reducing the work time from 12 to 15 hours a day to 8 hours. The Communist Manifesto, written by Karl Marx and Engels in 1848, had a great impact on workers across various countries who were feeling the heat of industrialization. And the crop failure in the 1840s led to widespread anti-feudal upheavals called the revolutions of 1848. As a result, the International Working Men's Association, known as the First International, was born in the year 1864 as an umbrella association for all the socialist and communist organizations at a workers' congregation in London. After the First International dissolved in the year 1876 over an ideological rift, the Second International emerged in the year 1889 as a united outfit of socialist and labor parties, which was known as First International Socialist Congress. It was this organization that declared May 1 as International Workers' Day. Historically, an event is referred to as the origin of May 1 as Workers' Day, the Haymarket Affair or the Haymarket Massacre. When laborers assembled at the Haymarket Square in the city of Chicago in the United States on May 4, 1886 and took out a rally for an 8-hour workday, a bombing attack was mounted on them by some unknown forces. Police firing and loss of about 11 lives were reported at the rally that ended up in riot. As for May Day in India, the country witnessed the first celebration of Labour Day in the year 1923 in the then Madras province. It was led by Singara Velar, leader of the Labour Kisan Party of Hindustan. And in its meetings, a resolution was passed urging the British government to declare May 1 as Labour Day and also as a government holiday. It was the first occasion in India on which the red flag was also used. And finally, note that the theme of International Labour Day for the year 2019 is Sustainable Pension for All, the Role of Social Partners. Have a look at the prelims question. It will be discussed at the end of the analysis session. With this, we come to the end of the analysis session. Let us now move on to the practice question discussion session. First question, consider the following statements with respect to tropical cyclones. Statement 1, it is characterized by a high pressure center. Statement 2, in this, the winds rotate clockwise in the southern hemisphere. And statement 3, eye of the cyclone is very calm and clear. Which among the above statements is or not correct? Keep in mind that we have to look for the incorrect statement. Here, the first statement is wrong as we have already discussed that tropical cyclones are characterized by low pressure center and not high pressure. The second statement here is correct as tropical cyclones winds rotate counterclockwise in the northern hemisphere and it rotates clockwise in the southern hemisphere because of the Coriolis force. The third statement is also correct as we saw in our analysis that the eye of the cyclone is very calm and clear. As we have to choose the incorrect statement here, only statement 1 is incorrect here. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. Moving on to the next question, in the context of 8 core industries, which of the following statements is or correct? Statement 1, it is published on a monthly basis by the Central Statistics Organization. Statement 2, crude oil has the maximum weightage in this index. And statement 3, the base year taken for calculation is 2011-12 and it has asked to choose the correct option. Here, the statement 1 is wrong because the index of 8 core industries is published by the Office of the Economic Advisor and not by Central Statistics Organization. The statement 2 is also wrong because the refinery products has the maximum weightage among core industries and it is not crude oil. Here, the statement 3 is correct. The base year taken for calculation of this index of core industries is 2011-12. So, the question has asked for the correct options. Here, the correct answer is option C, 3 only. Moving on to the next question. With reference to the index of industrial production, which of the following statements are correct? Statement 1, it is published on a weekly basis by Central Statistics Office. Statement 2, it comprises of three major industries, manufacturing, mining and electricity. And statement 3, mining has the maximum weightage in the index. It has asked us to choose the correct answer. Here the statement 1 is wrong. Index of industrial production is a monthly publication and not a weekly publication, and it is published by the Central Statistics Office. Here, statement 2 is correct. The index of industrial production comprises of mining, manufacturing and electricity. And statement 3 here is wrong because the manufacturing sector has the maximum weightage, which is 77.6% compared to 14.3% for the mining sector. So, the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. Moving on to the fourth question. Consider the following statements. Statement 1 reads, Article 239A provides for the creation of state legislature or council of ministers or both to the union territory of Puducherry. Statement 2 reads, Article 239AA provides for the creation of only the state legislature to the union territory of Delhi. Which among the above statements are correct? Keep in mind that we have to look for the correct statement here. The statement 1 is correct as Article 239A provides for the state legislature or council of ministers or both to the union territory of Puducherry. And here the second statement is wrong as Article 239AA provides for the creation of state legislature and also the council of ministers to the union territory of Delhi. Hence the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. Moving on to the final and the fifth prelims question, which organization declared May 1 as International Workers' Day? This is a very direct question about which we have already discussed in our analysis, and we know that the Second International is the organization that declared May 1 as the International Workers' Day. So the correct answer here is option D, the Second International. Let us now move on to the first practice mains question. The question is, India is in an urgent need of employment-oriented economic policy. Discuss. Since the question has asked you to discuss, you can start your answer by discussing the current scenario where we are noticing a jobless growth in our Indian economy. Substantiate with the facts shared in the first part of our editorial analysis and also with your statistics if you have any. Then mention the need of employment-oriented economic policy and give your suggestions on the same, on how employment is a real indicator of economic growth. You can also discuss the role of government and RBI in the economic policy decisions that promotes jobless growth in Indian economy, in short. Moving on to the final practice mains question. The question is, discuss the impediments India is facing in continuing oil imports from Iran. In your answer, you can say if India continues the import, then it may impact the cost, the economic ties with USA, sanctions from US, US may not support NSG membership for India, civil nuclear deal may not be working, and next US may not support enlisting Masood Azhar as a global terrorist, and it may become difficult to contain China in Indo-Pacific region, etc. If India discontinues the oil imports from Iran, then it may affect the India-Iran relations as well. Primarily, India may lose Chabahar port, which means India cannot access Afghanistan, Central Asia through Iran. This will also result as a setback in Tuppy oil pipeline project, which may cost India's energy security. With this, we come to the end of the practice question discussion session. Please do like, comment and share the video. And please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.